Dear friends, before I share my thoughts with you today, I just want to express my gratitude for your indulgence in what may be a repetitive argument, but I feel compelled to address over and over again what the scientific community calls the two open questions in science. Open means we don't have the answers. The two most open questions in science. Number one, what is the universe made of? And what's the basis of consciousness? Actually, the question that's posed is what's the biological basis of consciousness? So I once again want to address this really in deep detail and unpack this again for all of us. And remember, if you have any further questions, you can always engage with me on digitaldeepak.ai. And I'll be happy to answer your questions and continue this conversation. So the two most open questions in science, once again, what's the universe made of? Short answer, it's made of nothing. Second open question in science, what's the biological basis of consciousness? Short answer, there's no biological basis of consciousness. Biology is an experience in consciousness. But now let's unpack this in detail because as science works currently, which is the philosophy of naive realism, this question will never be answered using the usual scientific methods. We need to actually expand science to include the elephant in the room, which is fundamental reality as consciousness. Going back to fundamental concepts in science right now. In the quantum realm, reality exists as a sea of infinite possibilities, manifesting as probability waves that extend across the non-local universe. These waves of potential remain in superposition, unbound by space and time, until the act of observation collapses them into what appear as localized particles. Consciousness, the fundamental fabric of existence, underlies all measuring systems and acts as the observer that brings forth material reality. When consciousness focuses its attention on its own probability waves, it modifies the quantum field, localizing probability waves into the appearance of particles and tangible objects. This process bridges the micro-quantum and the macro-classical domains. Biological organisms, from single-celled amoeba to complex beings, serve as intricate systems of observation. Our bodies and minds are not separate from the universal field of consciousness, but rather expressions of it, constantly collapsing quantum possibilities in its own awareness into experience reality. So extend this concept to the cosmic scale, and then we can look at dark energy and dark matter as vast reservoirs of probability within consciousness. These mysterious forces, which defy known laws of physics, represent the infinite potential from which our evolving universe continually emerges. As cosmic consciousness observers interact with these probabilities, and what manifests is the observable universe in a process of ongoing creation and evolution. So, of course, in this view, consciousness is not a product of physical evolution, but the primal field from which all of reality, including space-time and matter, arises. The universe, in essence, is a self-aware field of consciousness, constantly observing itself and then creating itself. So this leads to another very important question, and that is, what is the observer? So what is the observer? And what I'm going to argue with you is that the observer ultimately is a single non-local field of infinite possibilities. If you ask scientists this question, what is the observer? Please explain what the observer is. Then scientists will usually say any classical system is an observer. So Deepak Chopra is a classical system as a biological organism is an observer. Furthermore, you know, instruments that extend the range of our experiences are all viewed as observers. When a quantum system interacts with the classical system, it is argued that it is sufficient to cause wave function collapse. This allows for the existence of so-called objective reality, independent of consciousness. I am saying that this is incorrect. There are strong arguments for why consciousness is the ultimate observer, even in quantum mechanics. So let's unpack this as well. First, address the measurement problem. The measurement problem in quantum mechanics refers to the fact that it is unclear exactly when and how wave function collapse occurs. If classical systems can act as observers, it is unclear where to draw the line between quantum and classical systems. Consciousness seems to be a more natural place to locate this boundary. And maybe you've heard of the quantum Zeno effect, first described by an Indian physicist called Chandra Shekhar. The quantum Zeno effect demonstrates that repeated measurements can freeze the evolution of a quantum system. Consciousness seems to be required to perform these repeated measurements rather than a classical system, which would be expected to decohere. Let's address subjective experience. Consciousness is the only thing we have direct subjective experience of. All of our knowledge of the so-called external world comes through our conscious experience. It seems more parsimonious to ground the collapse of the wave function in the only thing we have direct access to, which is our own minds going back to their source as consciousness. Let's look at biological organisms. Biological organisms, including humans, are classical systems in many ways. However, they are also quantum systems at the atomic and molecular level. It seems unlikely that the mere fact of being a classical system is sufficient for being an observer. Consciousness is what distinguishes biological organisms from other classical systems. So, while classical systems can make observations in a practical sense, consciousness is the ultimate observer in quantum mechanics. The measurement problem, quantum Zeno effect, subjective experiences, and the role of biological organisms all point to consciousness as the key factor for its wave function collapse. This suggests a central role for consciousness in our fundamental physical theories. Okay. Now, let's go a little further again to unpack this, because let's look at biological systems not as observers, but as instruments of observation in quantum mechanics. So quantum effects have been observed in biological systems, suggesting organisms may interact with quantum phenomena. For example, bacteria have been shown to exploit quantum mechanical effects like vibronic mixing in photosynthesis. Some experiments have attempted to place living organisms in quantum states. One study claimed to put bacteria in a state of quantum entanglement with light, though the evidence was indirect and became controversial. The field of quantum biology explores how quantum mechanical effects may play a role in biological processes like enzyme catalysis, sensory processes, energy transfer, and information coding. So the boundary between quantum and classical behavior in biological systems is now becoming a very important area of research. Proving that biomolecules exhibit quantum effects would be the next step. And many researchers are exploring more ambitious experiments, trying to put all kinds of instruments and extensions of sensory processes, and looking at quantum superposition states. So biological organisms may interact with quantum phenomena in some ways, but in fact, my position right now is biological organisms themselves are instruments or modes of observation and not the fundamental observer, which is always non-local consciousness. So now, this is the solution to the two most open questions of science. Do not ignore consciousness, without you which you can not even ask the open questions in science. Without consciousness, you cannot do science. Science is an activity in consciousness. As I've said many times before, theories are conceived in consciousness, experiments are designed in consciousness, observations are made in consciousness. So consciousness collapses its own field of infinite possibilities as clouds of probability, which then appear as the so-called physical universe, including our body minds and other organisms, biological organisms, all as an entangled web of relationships in the non-local mind or non-local consciousness. And therefore, simple answer, there is no physical universe. The physical universe is the appearance that we see. Stars, galaxies, rocks, amoeba, bacteria, animals, primates, humans, in an ecosystem, an entangled ecosystem from clouds of probability. And in this scenario, actually, both dark energy and dark matter are aspects of consciousness itself, aspects of cosmic consciousness itself, the invisible that makes the visible possible. So please respond to me. If you find this argument convincing, then share it with other friends, both lay people and physicists or scientists or biologists, and let's continue to explore fundamental reality, because it is the next frontier in science and also will lead to a new paradigm where our place as human beings will become fundamental to the manifestation of the so-called physical universe. And of course, we can continue this conversation if you go to digitaldeepak.ai, and we can continue to engage and explore fundamental reality together. It's very important, because this paradigm shift will answer all the questions: multiple lokas, multiverses, what happens after death, the mystery of the human mind that can connect with the cosmic mind. So much to explore, but I need your participation. Thank you.